I want to welcome you to the Wednesday night service here at Lakewood. Thanks so much for joining us. We especially extend our welcome to the extended Lakewood family all around the world. We love you. We pray for you every day. And we know that God has good plans for your future. I'm excited about the message tonight. Our passage is found in 1 Thessalonians. But before we get started, let me just open with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the opportunity to gather with your brothers and sisters, our brothers and sisters here tonight. Lord, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for your kindness, your faithfulness. Lord, we thank you for your word that is alive and powerful. Thank you that it can change our life. Thank you that it's a seed that can be placed in the good soil of our hearts and it can make a difference in our lives, Father. Lord, we just pray that tonight that we would have a revelation of you, that we'd have a spirit of revelation so that we could know you better. Lord, we pray that what is hidden in your word would become alive and revealed to us tonight through the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, like the two men on the road to Emmaus, Father, may our hearts burn within us as you open the scriptures to us, Lord. Be with my brothers and sisters, Lord. I don't know what they're going through, but you do. Strengthen, encourage, heal, lift, deliver. Father, whatever they need, Father, I pray that you would be that exactly what they need, Father, tonight, to encourage and bless and strengthen them, Father. So, Lord, thank you for this time. We pray that you'd quiet our hearts and quiet our minds. You'd make our minds receptive, our hearts receptive to your word. And that, Father, that we would, as we listen to your word, we would not only be listeners, but we would be doers. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I want to talk to you tonight about being an encourager, developing a lifestyle of encouraging others. Being known as someone who encourages people. If there was ever a time that we all need encouragement, it's right now. We're in the middle of a lot of things that can bring us down and discourage us. A pandemic, a divided nation, racial tension, economic hardships, all sorts of conflict and heartache around the world. Everyone needs encouragement right now. Did you know the Bible actually commands us as believers to encourage one another? It's not optional if you feel like it. It's not optional if someone deserves to be encouraged. In his first letter to Thessalonians, Paul encourages us to encourage one another and build each other up. The writer of Hebrews goes on to say, encourage one another daily, not occasionally. This should be something that we do on a daily basis. The dictionary defines encouragement as the act of inspiring others with renewed courage, hope, or renewed strength. In other words, encouragement is building each other up with a transfusion of courage, a transfusion of hope, and a transfusion of strength. When I practiced surgery, I'd make my rounds on my patients in the hospital. Many times I'd see one of my patients who had lost a lot of blood, maybe from surgery, maybe from an accident, or maybe from internal bleeding. And when I would talk to them, they'd say, "Doc, I just don't have any strength. I can't even lift my head up off the pillow." And when I would examine them lying down in the bed, they would be pale, their blood pressure would be low. And if I tried to help them stand up, they would lose strength and they would faint. Why is that? You see, our blood carries oxygen, and oxygen supplies life and energy and strength to our body. When you're low on blood, you're low on life and energy and strength. Often I'd make a decision to transfuse these patients with a couple of units of blood. So the nurses would go down to the blood bank and they would pick up blood that someone else had donated. Think about it, life and strength from somebody else's body that we were able then to transfuse into my patient. And an amazing thing would happen. The next morning on rounds, many times they weren't in their bed. They were out walking in the halls. Their cheeks were rosy. They had a smile on their face and they'd say, "Doc, I feel so much better. I feel like I have life and strength and energy again." That's what encouragement does. It transfuses life and strength and courage and hope from us to those around it who so desperately need it. And friends, we have the opportunity and really the responsibility as followers of Jesus to do that every day to the people God brings across our path. Who needs encouragement? We all do. The world we live in is negative and discouraging and tries to tear us down. Your wife needs encouragement. Your husband needs encouragement. Parents, your children need encouragement. The people that we work with need encouragement. The lady at the grocery checkout needs our encouragement. Those that we know that are fighting battles, those that are weary, those that have suffered loss or made mistakes, they all need our encouragement. Think about it. Every day God brings people into our lives, and every encounter we have with these people can be an opportunity to encourage them, to build them up, to transfuse them with courage and strength and hope. Let me give you a few characteristics of an encourager. First one I'd like to talk about is that an encourager uses their words to build people up. Proverbs tells us, "The mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life." Later on in that same chapter, Proverbs says, "The lips of the righteous nourish many." Think about it. Our words can be a fountain of life. They can nourish people. Proverbs also tells us that the tongue has the power of life and death. The Message translation says it like this: "Our words kill or our words give life. They're either poison or fruit. You choose." Friends, our words have power. They should give life and nourish those around us. They should be fruit and not poison. When we encourage people with our words, it's like we pour water on a wilted plant. Within minutes, those leaves that were sagging and drooping and wrinkled come to life again. Words like, "I know it's hard right now, but you're going to make it. Don't give up. Your best days are still ahead. I'm praying for you. I believe in you. I appreciate you. You're doing a great job." These are the kind of words that bring life into wilted lives. These are the kind of words that transfuse strength and courage and hope into people. My dad was a master at this. During my training in surgery, it was very hard. Many days I didn't feel like I had the strength to go on. Often I'd come home and there would be a message on my answering machine, and it would be my dad. The message would go something like this: "Hello, Paul, this is your dad. I'm just thinking about you. I'm proud of you. You're gonna make it. I love you." Those were words that brought life to my wilted soul. Those were words that gave me the strength and the courage to keep going on. Our words of encouragement can be handwritten in a letter or a note or an email or a text. My wife Jennifer does this all the time. The Holy Spirit will bring someone to her heart and she'll sit down and write them a note of encouragement and put it in the mail. So many times those notes have come just when people needed encouragement the most. My mom uses her words to encourage people. I can't tell you how many people I've met that tell me, 10 years ago, I was going through a struggle. Your mom sent me a little note. It helped me make it through that dark valley. And I still have that note today. You know, I keep a file at home with notes of encouragement that people have written me over the years. On my phone, I have these encouraging voice messages that I've saved that people have sent me. Words that I go back to and listen to and read. Words that encourage and strengthen me when I'm discouraged. You see, friends, our words have power. We need to take the time and make the effort to use our words to encourage the people that God brings into our lives every day. We can encourage people with our words, but we can also encourage them with our actions. Let me give you a second point. An encourager is sensitive to the specific needs around them, and then they take action. Remember Jesus' words in Matthew 25? "I was hungry and you gave me something to eat, thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in, naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you visited me." The disciples asked, "Lord, when did we do this?" Jesus said, "When you did it to the least of these, my brothers, you did it for me." I want you to notice two things about this passage. First, notice that Jesus didn't commend giving clothes to the hungry or something to eat to the thirsty. You see, if we're really going to encourage people, we need to be sensitive to what they are going through, what they really need. And then second, it's not enough just to be sensitive to their needs. We need to take action to encourage them. James says it like this: "Faith without works is dead." In other words, our faith needs arms and legs and action. If someone is battling a physical illness, encouragement to them may look like this: letting them know that you commit to pray for them and believe with them. Or perhaps visiting them in the hospital, or calling and checking on them every couple of days to see if there's anything they need. Or maybe it's taking them a meal or taking them to a doctor's appointment. We need to be sensitive to what people are going through, but then we need to take action to help them, to encourage them. I remember when my dad passed away, we were all gathered in a small room in the hospital for a couple of hours. We were alone as a family beginning to process our grief. After about an hour, there was a knock on the door, and there was Dr. Bill Henson, the pastor of First Methodist Church here in Houston. Dr. Henson had heard the news about my dad, And he immediately left what he was doing and he came up to the hospital. He tracked us down. And then he spent a few minutes with us, ministering to us, comforting us, and praying with us. That was 23 years ago, and I remember it like it was yesterday. Dr. Henson was an encourager, and he did what he could do to help us during that difficult time. Several years ago, I had a friend who admittedly made some big mistakes. He misappropriated and misused some funds. He was convicted and sentenced to prison. I felt very strongly one day that I should go up and visit him, so I made arrangements, and I took about an hour to drive to find where he was. And I went in and through a glass window talked with him for about an hour or so. I checked on how he was doing. I asked about his family. I asked if he needed anything. Then I prayed for him before I left. That was several years ago. Now he's out of prison. He's with his family. He's back at work and doing well. He recently told me that he will never forget that visit and the support and the encouragement that he felt during the darkest time he had ever experienced. It wasn't a big thing. It only took a few hours, but it was the least I could do to encourage my friend. I remember a time 30 years ago that I was alone again, and it seemed like the holidays were the worst time because they brought up all the fact that everybody else was having a good time with their family, and there I was alone. Late one afternoon, just before one of the holidays, my neighbor and I were working on a building project in my backyard, and he asked me very innocently, "Got any plans for the holidays?" And of course I didn't, and it brought up all this pain and all this rejection and all this loneliness. About that time, the UPS man walked around the back of my house and he gave me a big heart-shaped box of chocolates. And there was this little note inside from my sister Tamara in Victoria, Texas that said, "I love you and miss you. You will make it through this difficult time." Those were some of the sweetest chocolates and some of the sweetest words for one of the most bitter times in my life. You see, my sister Tamara is an encourager. She was sensitive to the needs of her brother, and she took action to encourage me. Let's encourage each other with our words, and let's encourage each other with our actions. Let me give you another characteristic of an encourager. An encourager takes time to encourage new believers. So important. We all know as a new believer, you're vulnerable. So easy to get discouraged, feel all alone, or stumble and fall and let the enemy load you up with guilt and condemnation, and pretty soon you drop out of church and fall back into the world. This is when our new brothers and sisters need our encouragement the most. Ecclesiastes says this, "Two are better than one. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man that falls and has no one to help him." I have a friend named Jim. He told me the story of how several years ago he had a real life-changing experience with Jesus. Not long after that, while still a baby Christian, he stumbled and he fell into sin. Jim told me how he felt the weight of that sin and the disappointment that it had caused to those close to him, and how he was overwhelmed with guilt and condemnation. And then slowly but surely, he quit volunteering. Then he quit regularly coming to church with his family. When he did occasionally come, he would slip in late and he would sit high in the risers so that no one would notice him. But another friend of mine, a brother named David, is an encourager. And David took note that there was a problem with this new believer. And no matter how late Jim came in, or no matter how high up in the risers he sat, David would search him out. And sometime during the service, he would make his way up to Jim, and he would find him and he'd give him a great big bear hug, and he would say, "Hey man, I love you and I believe in you. You're gonna make it." Service after service, week after week, Jim tried to blend into the crowd, but David never let up. He always found him, always hugged him, and always told him that he loved him and he believed in him. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. David's words brought life to Jim. That was many years ago now. Where is Jim? He's fully restored. He's active as a ministry leader here at Lakewood. Why? Because an encourager picked him up and spoke life into him and restored him to fellowship. Friends, let's make sure we make an effort to encourage those that are new in their walk with Jesus. Let me give you a fourth characteristic of an encourager. An encourager always runs to the wounded and not away from them. So many times I hear stories of how one of our Christian brothers or sisters have become wounded. Maybe it's a divorce, or maybe it's a pregnancy outside of marriage, or they get trapped in sin, or there's a big moral failure. And then the rest of the Christian family leaves them, like they have the plague, or even worse, turns on them. Listen, don't ever quit hating sin, but don't ever quit loving your brothers and sisters who've made mistakes. They're wounded, and what encouragers do is to run to the wounded and not away from them. Don't leave them on the battlefield alone bleeding. Run to them and offer them help. I recently heard the story of Jim Baker. Many years ago, he founded a Christian TV network. Then he made some mistakes. He made a lot of poor decisions, a real lack of integrity when it came to handling money, and some real moral failures. He was guilty, there was no doubt. He had broken the law and deserved punishment. He was sentenced to prison, and after a while, his family either left him or were so embarrassed and disgraced by his failures that they rarely visited or called him. So he was living out his sentence, doing his assigned job, cleaning toilets, trying to deal with the weight of his sin and the loneliness and the dark depression that came with it. He related that at one of the darkest times, one of the most depressing times, the jailer told him that he had a visitor. "But it's not visiting day," he contested. "Come on," the jailer said. "They've already made an exception for you." They brought him into a room to await his visitor. As he sat down, he hung his head and he looked down at his tennis shoes that had big holes in the toes. And he realized that his clothes smelled of the toilets that he had been cleaning. As the jailers opened the doors and closed them, he looked up, and there with wide arms open was a tall, gray-haired older gentleman. It was Billy Graham. And Jim said, "Brother Graham, I just finished cleaning the toilets. I'm filthy." But you know what? Those arms stayed wide open. As Billy Graham said, "None of that matters to me, Jim. I'm just here to encourage you. I'm just here to tell you that Jesus loves you and that Ruth and I love you. We know you've made some mistakes, but we still believe in you, Jim. It's not over yet. God still has plans for your life." You see, Billy Graham may have been a great evangelist, but he was also a great encourager. He ran to the wounded and not away from them. No matter what someone has done, we need to love them, we need to move toward them, and we need to remember that they are still valuable in our Heavenly Father's eyes. And we need to realize that God still has good plans for their lives. We need to do everything we can do to encourage them. I want to tell you about a man in the New Testament who was a real model of an encourager. His name was Joseph, and he was from the island of Cyprus, and he was an early Jewish convert to Christianity. The first time we see mention of Joseph is in Acts 4, where he recognized there were needs in the church at Jerusalem, and he took action, just like we've been talking about. He sold a piece of property that he owned, and he brought the money to the apostles, and the money was used to meet the needs of the church. In Acts 9, we see Joseph again. This time, there's a new convert in Jerusalem by the name of Saul, a man the apostles knew well, a man who had terrorized the early church. But now Saul claimed that Jesus had appeared to him on the road to Damascus. And when he came to Jerusalem to tell the disciples about his conversion, they were all afraid of him. They didn't believe the story he was telling. But Joseph believed in Saul. He stood up for him and he took him under his wing and he took him to the disciples and said, "Listen, guys, Jesus has really changed this man's heart. He's the real deal. Let him be a part of our fellowship." You see, Joseph was an encourager, and he was quick to encourage this new believer. And then in Acts 11 through 15, we see where Joseph accompanied the Apostle Paul as they went on missionary journeys to establish and encourage and strengthen the new churches in Asia Minor. And then in Acts 15, Joseph and Paul get into a sharp disagreement over a young man named Mark. Mark had been a companion of Joseph and Paul on one of their missionary trips. When the going got tough, though, Mark abandoned them. He left and went back home. He made a mistake. He experienced a personal failure. Now Joseph wants to overlook that failure and give him another chance and let him come with him on another missionary trip. Paul wants nothing of it. The disagreement between Paul and Joseph was so sharp that they decided to part ways. Joseph took Mark with him. Paul took Silas with him. You see, Joseph ran to the wounded, not away from them. He basically said, "Mark, no matter what anybody else says about you, no matter even if the great Apostle Paul has given up on you, I haven't. You're still useful. God has plans for you, and I'm not going to give up on you." Is that the end of the story about Mark? Not a chance. 15 years later, in a Roman dungeon awaiting execution, the Apostle Paul pens the last chapter of the last letter he'll ever write. He tells of how everyone else has deserted him except for Luke, about how he's cold and he's lonely and he wants Timothy to come visit. And he says, "Hey, Timothy, bring my coat that I left in Troas and bring the books and papers I left." And then he went on to say, "Timothy, out of all the people that you could possibly bring with you, I want you to bring this one man. Why? Because he's helpful to me in ministry." Who was that one man? It was Mark, the very man that Paul, 15 years early, had wanted to give up on, a man who would go on to write the Gospel of Mark. What made the difference in Mark's life? What was it that took him from being forever on the sidelines, labeled a failure, and put him back into the ministry? Who was it that believed in him and encouraged him and stood by him when no one else did? It was Joseph. Who is this Joseph of Cyprus? The early disciples saw that Joseph was such an encourager that they decided to change his name from Joseph to Barnabas. What does Barnabas mean? It means the son of encouragement. I want to leave you with a challenge for the new year. In 2022, let's be known as Barnabases. Let's be known as sons and daughters of encouragement. Let's encourage people with our words because our words are powerful. Let's be sensitive to the needs of those around us and take action to encourage people. Let's make every effort to encourage new believers because they need it. And let's move toward those that are wounded and not away from them. Become a Barnabas to our friends, our neighbors, our coworkers, our boss, our spouse, our children, to those that God brings across our path each and every day. Encourage them with a smile or a handshake or a hug, with a text or a letter or a call or a visit or a meal. Let them know that you care about them and that you're praying for them and that God still has good plans for their lives. Friends, God places people in our lives for a reason. Let's do everything we can do to transfuse strength, transfuse courage, and transfuse hope to those around us who so desperately need it. Let's be encouragers in 2022. If you received that word, would you say amen? I know you did. Let me just pray for you. Thank you, Lord, for this word that we've heard. And Lord, even for myself, we just want to take this to heart. We want to be not only hearers of your words, we want to be doers, Father. We pray that in Jesus' name. Maybe you're here before you leave tonight. I want you to just keep your heads bowed if you would. And maybe you're here and you've never made Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life and you want to do that. Maybe you feel like Him, He's tugging at your heart and you know it. Maybe even as I was speaking, you felt that. If you want to make Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life, I want to pray with you in just a minute. Or maybe you knew the Lord at one time, but you've drifted away. Kind of like my friend, Jim, you're not living right, you're not doing right, and you want to have a new beginning with Jesus. If that's you, I'm going to pray with you as well. So if you've never made Jesus the Lord and Savior of your life, or if you want to come back to Him, I want you to pray this prayer with me right now. Just say, "Oh God, I know without Jesus I'm lost, but I don't want to be lost. I want to be saved. I ask you right now to forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Make me new. I thank you that you're now more than my God. You're my heavenly Father, and I'm going to serve you every day of my life. I thank you that now Jesus is the Lord of my life." If you prayed that prayer, friends, we believe that you got born again, and we believe that your best days are still ahead. As Joel always encourages you, come back on a regular basis. If you can't find a local community church in your area, tune back in and let us become your church. Tune in every week if you can. Tune in on the weekends. Tune in on Monday night Bible study or Wednesday night service. Let us feed you the Word of God because that first year of your Christian life is so important. As you do that, we believe you'll grow in the things of God. And we know one thing, that God has good plans for you, plans for a future full of hope, not for evil, but for good. We love you. We care about you. We pray for you each and every day. We look forward to seeing you again this next weekend. God bless.